Good morning. So I thought I'll start with a small update on the progress that we are having. So we have close to 60 members right now, and in the level 1, and around one person in the level 2, that is learning software PHP MySQL. And yesterday we were able to post one job opportunity in the WhatsApp group. Of course, that was not for a software programmer completely, but even having said that, it is a job opportunity, and I hope that someone will be able to find a suitable job there. So I thought I'll start with this, and next we will go on to the content. So before we start, we'll have to open a new window or a tab and open training.rizola.com/software. So you can directly go to this page so that you can log in without having to go to the main page. So once you come here, log in with your user ID and password. And every day without fail, mark how you have spent time in each of these things. As I tell always, if you do not balance your life in all areas of life, it will be very tough for you to program, because the programming is all about the mind and how clear your mind is. So the more clear your mind is, the better you will be at programming. So ensure that you're having a well-balanced life, and take some time out to reflect, and ensure that you are able to focus on all areas of life. Please do that. So let's get into the project. And here we can see that next is background color and border. So let's start off today's session and learn about background color and border. More than 1 hour. So that is what we're going to learn today. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll open the file that we have been using all along. So let me open that. Class and ID. So let me first this one. Let me open it in Notepad first. So this is a file that we worked till yesterday. So I will save as. I will create a new file with today's date of 22nd, and we are going to do background color and border. These are the two things that we're going to learn today. And let me save that. And this newly saved one, I will open it in the browser. So I will open it on the this one, on this browser, on this tab. Okay. Yeah. So this is active, it will automatically come over here. So this is what we created till yesterday. And today we are going to discuss on background color. So what I'll do is let me first update here that I'm going to do background color. And as I said, though in India we have the spelling as C-O-L-O-U-R, the color spelling used here is C-O-L-O-R, it is the US English. So this is what we're going to do right now. So let me open this. So what I'll do is I'll keep this on the left side and I'll keep this on the right side so that it is easier. So what I'll try to do is I'll create a background color for the div. Okay, so yesterday what we have done is we have created a class, okay, with a name called div class, and at the bottom we have put a dot here saying that it's a class, and we have given all the styling over here at the bottom. That is what we did yesterday. Now I'll show you something different. I mean, I can either add the background color here at the bottom inside the class, or I can still keep it over here. That is, I can still say style is equal to double quotes and say background color, let's say gray. I'm not sure if gray will work, so I'll put it as green. Okay, so when I say green, what is supposed to happen is whatever is over here, the background color here should become green. Now, you may see that I have put a div here, but I'm also putting a style here. Now, let's see what happens and then I'll explain to you why it happens like that. Okay. So, when I save this and I come here and refresh this file, you can see that the background has become green. Okay. Of course, it doesn't look... the text is not that visible, so let me change it to yellow so that the blue color text is visible. Okay, you can change it to anything you would want. Of course, you can even keep the color text. I'll get into that later on. Now, HTML CSS recognizes few of the colors like red, green, blue, yellow, maybe few other black and all that white. So you can use the text itself to represent few colors, but of course there you can go to any extent of color, which we will cover later. So here what is happening is you have a div with styles over here, and you also have a style with another CSS value over here. What happens is this particular styling is given first priority, then the second priority is given to this. For example, if I put a background color, let's say I remove this from here and I put a background color over here and I make it as, let's say I make it as red. Okay, I'm making the background color as red. So you can see that the same class, okay, the same div element is having a class defined style over here, okay. And also the same style is also repeated over here on the same div element, on the same div opening tag. Now what would happen is, from what I believe, from my experience, what would happen is it would pick up this particular local styling, which is the closest to it. The one on the class styling is given second priority. The first priority is given to this. So that means what I mean is, if I refresh this, you will still see the background as yellow and not as red. Okay. So let me refresh this and check what happens. You can see that it has become, it is remaining as yellow. So if I remove this, for example, if I remove the styling of yellow and then save it and I refresh it, what will happen? It will pick up from the div styling. So if I refresh this, it will become red. So this is how you do background coloring for various elements. I can even apply a background color for this table. Let's say I want to put the background color here as gray. Let's see if gray works. Background, send it down. Background color as gray. So let's see if it works. That is for the table. I'm trying to put for the table. That is for this particular thing here. I'm trying to say that the background color is gray. But before I do a refresh on this page, the coloring, background colors and all that for a table behaves little different from the way it behaves for a div. Okay, so let's see what happens when we refresh it. Okay, it's working correctly, but you will notice when you work more with background colors on tables, especially with rows and columns and all that, tr, td elements and all that, it behaves in a little different way. So whenever you see some different kind of behavior, all you have to do is just Google it, Google the scenario, and you will 100% find an answer. And the reason why I say that you will find an answer is because HTML is probably the most used programming language in the world. So you will find many people who have faced similar problems, and they would give you some kind of a fix, some kind of a solution. So you can do that. Okay, so we have completed the background color. So next, let us do the border. Okay, so let us do the border part. So coming to this and here, so now what I'll do is I'll put a border to this particular element here. Okay, to this one I want to put a border. So all I have to do is I can come down here and I can say border 1 pixel. Okay, now what happens is, if I save this and I refresh here, you'll see that nothing has happened when I say border 1 pixel. The reason is because though we are saying border 1 pixel, it requires a property of color for the border. And you have to put border color, let's say black. Okay, and let's see if it works. If I remember correctly, it should work. I don't know, it's not working. Border color black, and there is one more thing called border type solid. Let's see if it works. No, it's not working. So I'll have to Google it and check it. HTML border. So CSS border. Let's see what it says. So yeah, so border solid is right. Border style, what did I write here? Yeah, border type. It's not type, it is style. Okay, so border 1, border color black, border style solid. So when you put this and then when you come here and refresh it, you can see that a black color has come on the border. I can increase the, let's say, pixels to 4. I'll increase the pixel to 4, so that when I refresh it, you can see a much thicker black border. But you can see that assistance is almost touching onto the black border. So what I can do is, I can put a padding of, let us say, 10 pixels. So I told the padding is basically inside the element, the space inside the element. So if I refresh this, you will see that the space inside the element has increased. There's a 10 padding that is there over here. Okay, so this is how you create border. Now you can see here in this, you can see dotted, dash, double, groove. Okay, so you can see a lot of things here. Let us just try a few of them. So let me change the style to, let's say, dotted, and I'll save this and I'll come and refresh over here. You can see that it has become dotted, the border has become dotted. So that way you can, you know, go through all the things, so you can see the various things mentioned here. So that is the power of, you know, being clear with what you want and then doing a Google search of how to do it in HTML. See, for example, recently I picked up React Native, and it was completely new for me. It's a new programming language for me. And one thing that I was strong at is at least I knew what I wanted or what was required for the app that was getting developed. So all I had to do was, with that clarity, I had to go to Google and search, how do I do this in React Native? Because I know how to do it very well in HTML, CSS, Bootstrap, PHP, MySQL, C programming, probably even Python. But I don't know how to do it on React Native. And all I have to do is, with the clarity of what I want, I have to go to Google and search, not for an entire code so that I can take and copy and paste it. That's not going to work. You're never supposed to take code, complete lines of, you know, 10 lines or 100 lines of code and copy and paste and expect to get a good result. No. But when you know how a software is built, an entire, you know, the logic that it follows, and if you can pick up those construction blocks, each one of them, and when you use that and you put it in your clarity of thought, the software gets built and you get a good result. Okay, so we have come till here. So let us see what is next. Okay, so border is completed. So I'll say border completed. You can of course not do that, but I would love to do that. So let me come back to the course content and let us see where we are right now. So we have completed image, CSS, class, ID, style, margin, padding, height, width, color, background, color, and border. So we have completed all this, and the homework is nothing but you have to build a website writing down on a book. But we have gone much ahead of that, and we have actually built a literal website. Of course, this is not a website, it's a far cry if they call it a website, but at least we have created the code, we have written many of the elements. Of course, huge improvement can be made on this, which we will cover in the next classes. So next, let us come to the next topic. We will start off with Bootstrap. Okay, so let me mention Bootstrap. So we are starting Bootstrap. Okay. Now, what is responsive design? Okay, I'll give you a small idea. Responsive design is when the elements look, or the page website looks good on a larger screen or a smaller screen without having to zoom or zoom out, zoom in or zoom out. What I mean by that is, for example, if I open Rejola.com, okay, the website Rejola.com, on a little larger screen on a computer monitor, you will see that this is how it has been laid out. Okay, so it the menu has come on the top, the logo has come on the left side with a heading over here, some write-up. Now, what if I open the same thing on my mobile? How would it look on my mobile? Okay, so you can see that first of all, the menu has become smaller. Okay, it's not taking the entire space here because the size of the browser has become smaller. You can see that this has become, instead of two lines, it has become three lines. Okay, so and if I make it much smaller, if I make the page much smaller, you can see that the entire layout is changing. I'm not doing any zoom in or zoom out. All that I'm doing is I made the width of the browser smaller, and you can see that the whole layout is changing. Now that is called a responsive design, where the layout adjusts itself or changes itself according to the width and height of the screen, especially the width of the screen. So that is called a responsive design. Okay, so you can see that on this website, you even allow, or let me open. Okay, now you can achieve responsive design by various methods. There are probably plenty of ready-made tools available with which you can make your website into a responsive design. One of the tools which is quite popular and quite simple to understand is Bootstrap. Okay, so Bootstrap is a ready-made tool available, which is basically a collection of styling, CSS, and collection of JavaScript elements. Okay, though we have not covered JavaScript yet, we will do a little bit of JavaScript here, a little bit introduction of JavaScript here, and go forward because it's important. We need to complete Bootstrap. It is little important to understand JavaScript, not with respect to the coding level of it, but at least with respect to how it is used in Bootstrap and how can we use JavaScript in Bootstrap to make our website responsive. So we'll let us start off little with Bootstrap now. So what we will do is we'll go to the Bootstrap website. Okay, there is an official website for Bootstrap, and you will have to continuously go to this particular website. Okay, you will have to continuously keep visiting this website because you will have to refer to what is the latest and search for what is the Bootstrap command that you have to use, or a Bootstrap class as we would find out you have to use. And Bootstrap is evolving continuously, so they will keep changing. In fact, when I studied Bootstrap many years back, it was, I think, Bootstrap 2, and now the latest, I believe, is Bootstrap 4, and it is completely different. I mean, the classes that are used are completely different, but there's a good amount of difference in what is their latest. For example, when I studied Bootstrap, it used to divide the entire page into 12 parts. That's the standard way of doing it. But later on, I found out that Bootstrap no longer goes with the 12 division of the page. Instead, it has made it even more flexible. They have evolved to a much better level of, you decide how you want to divide the whole page, whether you want to make it 2 or 3 or 12, or probably even more than 12 parts. Now, please don't get confused. I'll explain what these parts and all are. But I'm just saying that always being and picking up what you want to do would be very important. So get used to this particular page here. So you can see that build fast responsive sites with Bootstrap, and it's free. Bootstrap is completely free, so you can pick up whatever is there for free. So you can say that the current version is 4.5. Okay, so there. Let us get started. Let me click on get started and probably just read a little bit and try to explain what it is. Okay, here. Get started with Bootstrap, the world's most popular framework for building responsive mobile-first sites with Bootstrap CDN and a template starter page. Okay. Here, I will have to tell a couple of things about how we can implement Bootstrap on the page that we have created here. Okay. So this is the code of the Bootstrap, of the website that we built here. Now, if I want to implement Bootstrap here, and if I want to make this page responsive, that is, see, one thing I'll admit, of course, this page will look the same even if it is on a big screen or a small screen. And we really wouldn't suffer a lot of difficulty with this page. Okay, so I think what we'll do is, since this page is not responsive, so I'll just talk a little bit about Bootstrap, and then probably we'll continue with what to do tomorrow. So as I was saying, Bootstrap, you can implement Bootstrap on a website in two different ways. One is you can download all the Bootstrap files. Bootstrap files basically are two. One is the styling file, that is the CSS files, and the other is the JavaScript file. So there are two types of files that you have to, you can download, and you can place those downloaded files along with your website. Okay, so that is one way of doing it. Let me, you know, increase myself, because yeah, so there's one way of doing that. You can download the entire files and keep it along with your website. Okay, so that is one way of achieving Bootstrap. Another way of achieving Bootstrap is you can refer to the online files of Bootstrap, which is stored in Bootstrap itself online. You need not download them. You can store them.